In this video, I will explain what Ansible is and show different real-life scenarios where it can be used to make IT processes efficient. We're going to look at Ansible components like playbooks and why it's a good idea to use Ansible with Docker. And at the end, we will compare Ansible with its alternative tools like Puppet and Chef. So what is Ansible? It's a tool that helps you automate different IT tasks. So now the question is, what are examples of such IT tasks and why is it important or better to do them automatically rather than manually? So let's go through these example tasks one by one. When you have a complex IT infrastructure with tens of servers, some IT tasks can be time-consuming and tedious to do manually. For example, imagine a scenario where you have 10 servers where your distributed application is running. Now let's say you release new application version and you need to deploy that on all those servers. Or another scenario where you want to update Docker version on all those 10 servers. Sometimes such upgrades might involve multiple steps like restarting some processes, reconfiguring the environment, etc. Or yet another example of repetitive tasks that system administrators perform and often take hours to do manually, such as updates, backups, weekly system reboots, creating users, assigning groups and permissions to these users, etc. So in all these scenarios, manual approach will be that you SSH into the first server, do the necessary configuration there, then SSH into the next server, do the same there, and so on for all 10 servers. And every time this configuration or upgrade or deployment needs to happen again, you need to start from scratch and go through that whole process again. And especially if it involved multiple steps, you'll have to remember exactly what you did the last time. One approach that I've personally seen in my projects was that people would just write notes and document in Confluence pages all the things they configured or changed on the servers to deploy an application, or steps of how they installed a certain software so that they can remember it when they need to do it again on the same server or on other environments. So now Ansible comes in to make all these different scenarios much more efficient and less time consuming in four different ways. So one, you can execute all these tasks like updates and deployments, etc., on all the servers from your own machine remotely instead of going into each server one by one. Second, you can do it by writing all the steps of configuring, installing, deploying, etc. in a single YAML file instead of doing it with manual steps or combination of shell scripts and manual steps. Three, you can reuse the same file to execute the same task sequence multiple times if needed, on the same server when you're doing re-upgrade, for example, or on different environments like when you're trying to create the identical environments on dev, staging, and prod environments. Number four, also a big plus, since humans are prone to make mistakes or forget stuff, especially when it comes to executing complex sequence of IT tasks, automating it with tools like Ansible makes it more reliable and less likely that errors will happen when configuring servers or deploying applications. And right now, the state of Ansible is that whatever IT or system administration task you can imagine, starting from OS level updates to cloud provisioning, you can do all of them with Ansible because it really has expanded so much that it supports all operating systems, a lot of different cloud providers, works with virtual cloud servers, as well as bare metal infrastructure. And only thing you have to do in order to execute these Ansible files on the target servers from your own control machine is simple SSH access to the target servers. And that's one of the unique advantages of Ansible compared to its alternative tools, that it's agentless. So what does it mean? Normally, when you want to use some tool on a machine, you need to go to the machine and install an agent for that tool. To use Ansible, however, you don't have to install anything on the target servers. You just install it on one machine, which is your control machine, could be even your laptop. And that machine can now manage a whole fleet of target machines remotely. So this means, one, you don't have any deployment effort at the beginning, and second, you don't have an upgrade effort either when moving to a new Ansible version. So now this probably helps you understand the basic concepts of when Ansible is used. So now let's see how Ansible actually works to carry out all these tasks. Ansible works with modules, and modules are basically small programs that do the actual work. They get sent from the control machine to the target server, so they get pushed out there. They do their job on the target server, like install an application, stop a process, apply firewall rules, etc. And when they're done, they get removed. And it's important to note here that modules are very granular. One module does one small specific task. So you have a module to create or copy a file, a module to install an Nginx server, or module to start that installed Nginx server, or to start a Docker container with some arguments, or create a cloud instance. So all of these are specific tasks that represent a module. And Ansible has hundreds of modules that each execute a specific task. And as I mentioned before, with Ansible, you can basically execute any IT task, and that's because of all these modules. So it has modules for many different cloud tools like AWS or Google Cloud. It has modules to work with Docker or many different databases and CI/CD tools, different networking security tools, and the list goes on. So if you want to execute an IT task, there's a high chance that there is an Ansible module to do that. You can see the whole list of modules and how to use them in Ansible official documentation, which I will link below along with all other relevant resources. Another important distinction of Ansible and big reason of why it became so popular is that Ansible uses simple YAML language, which means it doesn't require learning any special language because it's super intuitive. So let's see some of the examples of module usages in YAML. So this is an example of a Jenkins module, and with it you can do many different things in Jenkins. In this example, it's just creating a job and then deleting a job using different arguments. Or a Docker module that can be used to create, restart, delete containers, or even apply some configurations to them. And also an example of a Postgres module to also do a lot of different DB tasks like creating a table, setting user privileges, etc. Now, as I said, modules are very granular and very specific. So obviously when you're making some complex configuration or deploying an application, you will need multiple of such small modules in a certain sequence grouped together to represent that one whole configuration or all the steps to deploy the application. So that's where Ansible playbooks come in. So first of all, the sequential modules are grouped in tasks, where each task makes sure the module gets executed with certain arguments. These are the arguments. And also describes the task using the name. So here we have an example of group of tasks where a table gets renamed, and the owner gets set, and then the table gets truncated, all using PostgreSQL module. Or you can also execute multiple modules in a sequence. So here you have a module file that basically creates a directory for Nginx. Then you have YAML module that installs Nginx, and then you have a service module that starts that installed Nginx. And that will get executed exactly in that sequence. And that will be one configuration, so to say. Now we've defined a sequence of tasks that should be executed, but we also have to define where or on which target machines these tasks should be executed. And we do that using the hosts attribute, which in this case says that the following tasks here should be executed on databases hosts, and we also define with which user those tasks should be executed. And the remote user is the user that will execute these tasks on that server. And here we are connecting with a root user, but you can also connect as a non-root user and then escalate to root user privileges if needed. And note the indentations here. So as I said, YAML is a very intuitive, simple language, but it's very strict about indentations. So the hierarchy or the levels of where each attribute appears is actually very important. Another concept is that when you have, let's say, a recurring value like our table name here, which is used in many different places, you can use variables in Ansible. And the way to do that is on the same level here, you can define vars attribute where you can define your own variables. And here I've just defined table name, which is foo, and table owner. And you can simply use the variables using double curly braces. And this whole block here that defines which tasks should be executed on which hosts and with which user, plus maybe some additional attributes, is called a play. And in a single file, you can have multiple such plays which maybe depend on each other or needs to be executed in the sequence. So here, for example, we have a play for web servers where these following tasks get executed on web server hosts. And we have another play where a bunch of tasks get executed on databases hosts. And the file that contains one or multiple plays is called a playbook. So playbook basically describes how and in which order and where, meaning on which machines, the modules, which are part of the tasks, should be executed. Or in other words, it orchestrates the module execution. And in a playbook, you can name your plays using the name attribute, just like you can name the tasks, which actually is a good practice because it kind of summarizes in plain English what the play does. Now in the plays, we've defined this hosts attribute, but where do the values of this hosts attribute actually come from? Or which host do they refer to? And that reference is defined in Ansible's inventory list, which looks like this. So in Ansible, you have this hosts file that basically keeps a list of inventory, where inventory is all the machines that are involved in Ansible task executions. And you can define the entries in that hosts file as IP addresses or the host names. And this syntax right here that basically groups multiple IP addresses or host names together so that you can reference them as a group. So let's say you have a play that should execute on all your databases and you have 20 of them. So you can group them here and then reference it using that group name. And these host names or the IP addresses could be of cloud instances, virtual or bare metal servers. Now that should give basic understanding of what Ansible is and how it works. But there are a couple of other things worth mentioning here. So the first one is Ansible's usage for Docker. Usually when you want to create Docker containers, you write Docker files, which basically prepares the application environment. So you have the application artifact, which could be a jar file, for example, and then you define in Docker file which config file should be copied into the environment. Maybe a directory should be created where the log files will be stored. You define and set environmental variables, and maybe you also copy in a start script that should be executed, let's say, before the application starts. So all of this basically prepares the environment for the application startup. And with Dockerfile, that will produce a Docker container with application and its prepared environment. With Ansible, you can actually create an alternative to Dockerfile, which is more powerful. You can take the same type of configuration with application artifact and all these things around it. And instead of just creating Docker container, you can basically create a Docker container. You can create a vagrant container from it. You can deploy that application and all this environment on a cloud instance or even a bare metal server. So basically what this means is that Ansible allows you to reproduce the application across many environments and not only Docker container. Another advantage of doing that is that you can not only manage the Docker container, but also the host where this container is running. So for example, if container has dependency on the storage of the host or the network, using Ansible, you can manage all these different parts, which can make it possible to create one play in a playbook that basically executes tasks both on a container and the host level. Another interesting part of Ansible is Ansible Tower, which is a UI dashboard from Red Hat, which basically gives you a way to centrally store all your automation tasks across teams where you can configure permissions for those teams who can access and execute what tasks, where you can manage your inventory and have a good overview of which jobs have run and their health status. And finally, I should mention that there are alternative tools to Ansible, the most popular among them being Puppet and Chef, but there are two main reasons why Ansible may be more popular than those alternative tools and became more widely accepted. The first one is that while Ansible uses the simple YAML structure to define its tasks, Puppet and Chef use Ruby, which is more difficult to learn. And that makes Ansible much more appealing, especially for people who don't want to learn a new language and just want to get started with the tool immediately. The second one is that something that I mentioned at the beginning, that Ansible is agentless, meaning that instead of having to install an agent on every system you want to manage, you just need an SSH access. Whereas Puppet and Chef, just like any other tool, you have to install and then manage their updates on those target systems. So to summarize, as you see, Ansible or similar automation tools have the most benefits when you have complex environments where there are many moving parts, like multiple servers, dependent applications, complex application configurations, etc., where it could be even critical to use automation tools in order to prevent human errors and tedious, time-consuming manual work. Whereas in simpler setups with just a single server or more straightforward configurations, it can be optional to use such automation tools.